Thank you very much for welcoming me here. I'd like to introduce myself first. My name is Dr. Sebby Gabre-Madhin. I am a surgeon that joined the staff at Florida Hospital Waterman in October. I moved down here from Maryland. I did my training in Boston for the most part. I spent 7 years there. Then I was in Delaware in practice and then in Maryland. So I've been in practice about 10 years. And the topic that I'm going to speak to you about is one of my favorite types of surgery. As a general surgeon, we do a variety of surgeries, and thyroid surgery is just a surgery for which I have a special interest and a special love. And I'd like to thank Renee for this title. It's the thyroid, a little gland with big effects. I actually had a very boring title, a surgery of the thyroid gland. So this has a little bit of a meaning in terms of telling us why the thyroid gland is such an important gland and why thyroid surgery is one that is so exciting for so many of us. Basically, before discussing what one does surgically with a thyroid gland, let's talk a little bit about what the gland is, what it does, and its importance in terms of the body's function. The thyroid gland is sometimes described as the master gland of the body. It's a fairly small portion of the body considering its many functions, but it lives in the neck. And it's sort of a butterfly-shaped gland that overlies the trachea or the windpipe. It has two sides, which are not different in composition at all. They're just defined as the left and the right lobe of the thyroid gland by their position rather than by any differential in their function. The gland overlies the trachea below the larynx. And as we'll see later, as we describe the surgical anatomy of the thyroid gland, the thyroid is intimately associated with many important structures in the neck in terms of physical proximity. But sort of what's more important as an initial discussion of the thyroid gland is its importance in terms of regulating the body's functions. It's an endocrine gland, which means that it secretes its products inside fluid in the body into the blood in this setting. And it produces several hormones which have two primary functions. It's to increase the synthesis of proteins that are involved in most of the body's tissue and tissue functions, and to raise the body's level of oxygen consumption. A very simple way of thinking of the thyroid gland is an on-off, a thyroid hormone is an on-off switch, where the actions of the thyroid gland being present increase the on function or the synthetic function of the body. The regulation, because it's such an important gland or hormone that has many different functions, its regulation is also very, very well controlled by the body. And it's a multi-step regulation, but the regulation that the hormone that regulates the amount of function of the thyroid gland is called the thyroid stimulating hormone, and it's produced by the pituitary. As we talked about, the thyroid can be thought of as controlling the body's metabolism, and the effects in abnormal thyroid function can either be secondary to an increase or a decrease in that hormone production or that hormone level, which can cause hyper or hypothyroidism. And we'll go into a little bit more detail which one involves. But first, to talk about the regulation. The top layer of regulation is in the hypothalamus, which is centrally located in the brain. And then that hypothalamus will send a regulatory hormone to the pituitary gland, which is located more peripherally in the brain. And that pituitary gland is what produces the thyroid stimulating hormone that we're able to monitor as we're monitoring your thyroid gland function. The thyroid gland itself makes a variety of hormones, the major ones of which are labeled T3 and T4. And those, as we talked about, control the bodily functions. And what your body has is it has a sort of a closed circuit so that if there's an excess production of these two of the thyroid hormones, it sends a signal back to the pituitary and sometimes back to the hypothalamus, but majorly the pituitary, that sort of downgrades the pituitary's production of the TSH so that the pituitary no longer sends as much of a signal to the thyroid gland to produce hormone. So that's the way the body was able to regulate to its needs how much thyroid hormone is being produced by the thyroid gland. And as physicians, as your endocrinologist or as your primary care physician is monitoring how satisfied your body is, because every individual requires different levels of the hormone, as we're monitoring how satisfied your body is with the level of hormone present, the TSH is the major blood test that we use to study that. There are a lot of people in the United States that have thyroid disease. If you do a population studies, about 6% of the U.S. population has been noted to have some disturbance of the thyroid function. Lots of people, this is just a testing finding. Most people are not symptomatic. Another large portion of people are mildly symptomatic or symptomatic but have their symptoms that are able to be controlled with medication. A subset of people with thyroid disease will require surgery, including some with benign disease or some with cancers, which will almost all require surgery if surgery is an option. And let's talk a little bit about hypo and hypothyroidism. We talked about the fact that the gland can either over or underproduce. Hypothyroidism is actually a very common finding, particularly as people age. And you'll find a lot of people walking around with normal lives who have to take thyroid hormone replacement because they're hypothyroid. The symptoms of hypothyroidism can be fairly subtle or they can be fairly significant depending on the level and the individual. But essentially they reflect decreased metabolic activity. Some people describe a confusion or a decrease in their mental acuity. And one of the tests when we're looking at a diagnosis of a medically treatable cause of dementia is to look at the thyroid hormone levels. People can demonstrate cholesterol problems, loose skin, dry hair, depression, sleepiness, fatigue, weight gain, metabolism changes, inflammatory changes. And one of the key questions that we ask as part of our screening tests for metabolic disorders is it sort of tries to determine whether or not you're hyper or hypoactive by asking you how your temperature regulation is. And you know, the question that your doctor may ask you is, are you cold when other people in the room are warm, or are you hot when other people are cool or comfortable? Because that would indicate that your internal metabolism or your internal thermometer is not working appropriately, and that may indicate a thyroid problem. The converse of that is hyperthyroidism, where there's an overactivity of the thyroid gland. Some of the symptoms that you can get are peripheral muscle wasting, just from the excess revving up of the body. You can get a thinning of the hair. You can get a protrusion of the eyes called dexophthalmos, and I'll show you a picture of that a little bit later on. You can get a thyroid goiter. Although that's not necessary for hyperthyroidism. You can have sweating, anxiety, palpitations, or high heart rate. You can lose weight. You can lose menstrual cycles. And you can have tremors, usually fine tremors, that can be your presenting symptom. This is a nice picture of exophthalmos. You see how the eyes, this gentleman is not opening his eyes wide as I am. That's just how he lives. And it's a buildup of tissue in the posterior portion of the eye. It causes the bulging eye. Any good evaluation of the thyroid gland will involve a good history taking and a good physical examination. A thyroid gland is examined from two positions. It's examined anteriorly. Palpated anteriorly as well as posteriorly, as well as from the posterior, as you can see in the second picture. And basically that allows you to sort of see more subtle nodularity or irregularity in the gland. We also check for mobility of the gland, tenderness overlying the gland, and any associated enlarged abnormal lymph nodes. There's also laboratory testing that we do to monitor or to assess the thyroid hormone. And a lot of the basic tests are the thyroid stimulating hormone, which, as we talked about earlier, is a pituitary gland product that is an indicator of the body's perception of its hormone levels. So if your TSH is very high, it indicates that your body thinks it's not getting enough hormone. And if it's very low, it means that you're getting too much hormone. T3 and T4 are the products of the gland. Thyroid antibodies and thyroid globulin are used in situations where you're assessing for inflammatory changes. And calcitonin is another product of the gland, and the calcitonin-producing tumors are separately defined. Once an abnormality has been found, either by physical examination or by other means, the most common non-invasive but radiologic test is a thyroid ultrasound. And it's a very good way of looking at the thyroid gland. It's non-invasive, and it gives you good access. And if you can see in this image, this is an image of a benign nodule. And the important characteristics of this are that it has a discrete echo texture, that it looks different from the surrounding tissues. And you can tell it as distinct from the surrounding normal thyroid gland. But if you look at it, it has very regular borders. It doesn't seem to be creeping into the surrounding tissues, and it's well circumscribed. So that's a very benign appearance of the nodule. Of course, that's not the only characteristic. We look for other characteristics such as size and change as well before determining if something appears benign on ultrasound or does not. Another way of assessing another test that we can use to assess the thyroid gland is a nuclear scan, a thyroid scan. And it is often used as a further or a second level of evaluation rather than a screening or a first level test for thyroid disease. And it's more rarely used these days, definitely not a part of routine testing, but in certain indeterminate cases it can help in the management of the disease. And what the test involves is giving a radio tracer, which is taken up by the thyroid gland, and then used to produce thyroid hormone. So really the parts of the gland that are producing hormone are the ones that will take up the radioactive tracer. So the nodules that are working normally or hyperworking will be a hot nodule. The ones that are non-functioning will be a cold nodule. They won't take up that tracer because they're not making hormone. This is what the appearance would be. They can either be cold, hot, or neutral. If you're looking at the normal appearance of the gland, that's what's depicted by here. And you can have a nodule that just you can't even tell it's there. Its uptake is the same as the surrounding tissues. It can be hot, which indicates that it's hyperfunctioning, and that's actually a more benign appearance than this, which is a cold nodule, because a cold nodule means that that section of the gland, that nodule, is no longer working like a thyroid gland tissue. So it's de-differentiated, it's defunctionalized, so that's more suspicious for having a malignancy present. Another presentation, we talked a little bit about nodules. What you can also get is something called a thyroid goiter, which is just a diffuse enlargement of the gland that causes swelling. It can be toxic or non-toxic, and that refers to whether or not it's producing hormone. If it's producing an excess amount of hormone, we call it toxic. Most of them are non-toxic. They're just defined or diagnosed by their size and by their symptoms that they see in addition to the physical appearance. The exact cause is not always known, and in fact, in these days, it's often an unclear, unknown cause. Historically, iodine deficiency was a factor of goiter formation. In the United States, or in most of the world, actually, in this day and age, iodine deficiency is no longer a big problem, except in very rare populations, because most of the country and most of the world actually has food that's fortified with iodine, so that iodine deficiency is no longer a particular issue. If you see this goiter, see how large it is. We already talked about the fact that there are several structures present in the neck and that it's a closed space. So it can cause pressure symptoms, can cause difficulties with swallowing because your esophagus passes in a region relatively close to there. And it can definitely cause problems in breathing because your trachea underlies the gland, and it can cause pressure symptoms where people complain of difficulty breathing. And that's a fairly, significant complaint. The treatment options for a goiter are not always surgical. Their medical management is often initially tried, and what is tried often is to try to shrink down the size of the goiter by giving hormone replacement to try to defunctionalize the gland to see if it shrinks down, and that is sometimes successful. In the setting where a patient already has significant compressive symptoms, or where rapid growth has been seen, or there's a suspicion of malignancy, or there's a failure of medical management, then those patients are surgical candidates. And in the setting of a thyroid goiter, it's a disease that involves the entire gland, so the entire gland is removed. And that can be performed as a subtotal or a total thyroidectomy, and that's sort of just a term that means more to surgeons than patients. Basically, with a subtotal thyroidectomy, you're removing almost all of the gland, but leaving a thin rim of tissue in the back posteriorly so that it is a safer operation in terms of the other structures in the neck that we're trying to preserve. Another treatment for getting rid of the gland is a radioactive iodine ablation. And that's actually usually reserved for patients that aren't really good surgical candidates due to comorbidities. It's not really a first line of treatment or a first choice treatment in patients that don't respond to other medical management. The most common disease process that we see, however, that we as surgeons are asked to treat are thyroid nodules. Thyroid nodules refer to areas that can be seen to be distinct from the remaining thyroid gland. They can be solitary or they can be multiple. They can be located on one lobe of the gland or they can be bilateral. And of course, they may be cancerous or non-cancerous. The good news is, as we'll talk about in more detail later, most of them are not cancerous. As we see them and examine them, that's really the question that we're asking ourselves. What are the chances that this nodule, which is otherwise may or may not be symptomatic, is a cancer that needs to be removed? Again, the elements of working up a solitary thyroid nodule are the same. A good history, a good physical examination, laboratory testing that we described earlier, an ultrasound, and in certain cases, a thyroid scan. What determines how suspicious we are or how concerned we are about that nodule once present involves a multitude of factors. It's sort of a science, it's such an art as much of a science, but there are definite characteristics we look at. One is the size of the nodule, and of course if we have two time points, the rate of growth or lack of growth of the nodule. Suspicious characteristics, if you remember when I showed you the ultrasound earlier, very smooth wall around it. If instead of that it seems to be encroaching on surrounding tissues and violating the planes, that's much more suspicious. There are also patient risk factors. By that I mean that there are certain patient populations in whom the nodules have a higher chance of being malignant. And those are pretty well characterized. Men have fewer nodules, but actually have a higher incidence of cancerous nodules in the nodules that are found. People at the extremes of age, either very young people or very old people, that are found to have nodules. People that have a history of radiation to the neck. People that have certain family histories or family associations. All of those are people in whom we have to have a higher index of suspicion once a nodule is found. Characterizing the nodule, as we talked about, it's a little bit of an art, as much as very much a science. There are certain characteristics that favor benign. There are certain characteristics that favor malignancy. And if it's hot or warm on the scan, that's an indicator, as we talked about earlier, that it's functioning like thyroid tissue, and therefore that's a benign appearance. If it's cold, if it's dedifferentiated, if it's no longer taking up the tracer and no longer therefore thought to be producing hormone, then that's a suspicious finding. A family history of inflammatory thyroiditis or Hashimoto's thyroiditis is also protective. If you have evidence that nodule is producing excessive levels of hormone, then that's an indicator that it's probably benign. If it's painful or you could touch it and it's tender, that's an indicator that it's more inflammatory rather than malignant. If you have lots of different nodules, particularly lots of different nodules where there may be large nodules, but there's a lot of large nodules as opposed to one nodule that stands out. And then the characteristics of the nodule, if it's well-rounded, if it contains some cystic fluid, or if it just is purely a cyst, then that's obviously very benign. In terms of the other side of the spectrum, those that are concerning, we talked about the extremes of age, male gender, history of neck radiation. And these are characteristics of the nodule which make it, or the physical examination or history, which are suspicious. If it seems like it's there and then suddenly, and then rapidly symptomatic, if people have difficulty swallowing or become hoarse, that's an indicator that it's invading adjacent structures. If it, by appearance, feels to be fixed to the surrounding tissues, if it has an irregular appearance when you touch it, that's suspicious. And obviously, if there's associated lymphadenopathy or the lymph nodes in the area are enlarged, then that's suspicious. In many cases, we combine the level of suspicion that we get from all of the other information that we get with the information that we get from a fine needle aspiration. And that's a test that most, even medium or low-level suspicion nodules will get biopsied. And the reason for that is because it's a good test. It's minimally invasive, and yet it gives us very good information. And essentially what it involves is taking a very, very fine needle, using local anesthetic. It can be done in the office setting. It doesn't have to be in the hospital. You pass a fine needle through that nodule, and you take a sample of tissue, cells from that area, and you send them to the pathologist to be examined. In the setting of a palpable nodule, you can just take a feel and direct your needle through the skin. A lot of nodules are not palpable, so you require ultrasound guidance. And even in the setting of a palpable nodule, we pretty much recommend an ultrasound-guided biopsy or aspiration, because that allows you to check the path of the needle, make sure that the needle is exactly where you want it to be, and make sure that you're biopsying the area of the nodule that you're suspicious of. As we talked about earlier, some nodules may have some cystic components, some solid components. You really want to be biopsying in a solid, suspicious area of the nodule that you're feeling. The final aspiration, as I talked about, oftentimes will give us a good answer. There are, of course, sometimes when we do the biopsy and we get back an answer from the pathologist that they weren't able to come up with a diagnosis from the sample. The cells were inadequate. There was artifact, whatever it was. They can't come up with any sort of answer from that biopsy. In most times when we get that answer, unless the level of suspicion is minuscule, then the process is just to repeat the fine needle aspiration. And oftentimes, the second time you go through, whether you use a different technique, whether it's different timing, you're able to get an adequate specimen for them to give you one of the other, for them to be able to stratify it for you. The possibilities are that you may get back a FNA result that's benign. And the definition of that is that the risk of malignancy is deemed to be less than 1%. The treatment or the management of that is to repeat the ultrasound in 12 months without repeating an FNA as a standard, but one would repeat the FNA if there's any interval change in either the symptomatology, physical exam, or ultrasound. Indeterminate, a fair number of them come back as indeterminate. That means that they can't accurately gauge what it is, but about a 5 to 10% chance that this will eventually be diagnosed as having malignancy. The plan for that is to repeat an ultrasound and a fine needle aspiration in 3 to 6 months. Again, where you fall in that 3 to 6 months is a matter of personal preference in terms of different surgeons and different people have different management algorithms, and also based on the level of suspicion that you entered into the biopsy with. There's a very common finding is an atypical follicular pattern. There are follicular cells present. They're atypical. You can't tell whether or not it's malignancy in this setting, but there's a 20 to 30% chance that it is. In that setting, the referral is made to surgery, and it's for definitive excision. A smaller set are either suspicious for malignancy or clearly malignant, and those are also surgical treatments. This is just a little slide to tell you, as we talked about, most nodules that you end up biopsying or seeing are benign. 95% of them are benign. Only 5% or 1 out of 20 end up being carcinomas. Of the benign nodules, most of them are just hyperplastic nodules. They can be adenomas and they can be cysts. The reason that cysts is so low is because most cysts are taken out of the equation, because many palpable findings in the neck are actually cysts, but those cysts often don't get biopsied if they're simple cysts, so they don't fall in here, because you see on the ultrasound that they're a simple cyst and you don't biopsy them. Of the cancers, there are 4 different major subtypes. In decreasing order of incidence is papillary cancer, follicular and Hürthel cell type cancer, medullary cancer, and anaplastic cancer. It's fortunate in thyroid cancer that the incidence is inversely related to the mortality rate. In other words, the papillary cancer is the most common but the least likely to be to be fatal. Anaplastic is the most uncommon, but although unfortunately the most common, the most likely to cause death. Talk about the scope of the problem in the United States. In 2011, there were 48,000 new cases, most of which were in women, 36,550 in women, 11,470 in men. There were also 1,740 deaths of thyroid cancer in 2011. The lifetime risk of any individual living in the United States in 2011 of developing thyroid cancer was estimated to be at 0.097. Two things to get from there. One is that thyroid cancer is not a rare cancer, but it's clearly not the most common of cancers. And the second is that it's a cancer that is fairly commonly diagnosed but rarely kills you. And that's very good. Everybody has the little shtick lines that they repeat over and over again. And one of my lines that I talk to patients as we're talking about thyroid cancer is, if somebody gives you a menu and you have to pick a cancer and they list colon cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, lung cancer, et cetera, and thyroid cancer is one of the options, I would probably pick thyroid cancer, because as we'll talk about a little later, except for a very small subset of thyroid cancer, for the most part, you will be alive with the disease 5 years later if it's caught at an early enough stage and treated appropriately. This is sort of a retelling of the numbers, a slightly different estimation of the different incidences of cancer. About 80%, a little less than 80% are papillary or papillary type, 17% are follicular type, which includes Hürthle cell, 4% are medullary, and 1% is anaplastic. The thyroid cancer mortality and survival rates very much depend on both on two things. One is the subtype of cancer as well as the stage of cancer. And as we will sort of tease out a little bit later, the subtype of the cancer is more important than the stage of the cancer for the most part. If the tumor is initially detected when it's localized, before it's spread outside of the capsule of the thyroid gland, your chances of being alive 5 years from then are almost 100%. And about two-thirds of the people that are diagnosed with thyroid cancer will fall in this category. Even if it's spread to the lymph nodes in the area without spreading to lymph nodes that are far or organs that are far away, and that's how a quarter of the people that present with a disease present, you have a 97% chance of being alive 5 years after your diagnosis. If it's spread far, then you have a little more than 50% chance of being alive at 5 years. That happens in 5% of cases, and there's a certain number of cases that are unknown or unstaged, which doesn't really give you any information. So then we talked about the fact that the subtype of cancer is very important as well. And that's, if you look at papillary cancer, which most people will present with, your survival for stage one or stage two is 100%. And even when you're stage three, when you've spread out, you have a 93% survival. Stage four, widely metastatic or very advanced disease, you still have a 50% chance of being alive at 5 years. We talk about the numbers for follicular and medullary, slightly different and slightly not quite as great, but still pretty great. Particularly medullary is just a level below papillary and follicular. The worst player is the one that's the rarest subtype, and that's anaplastic. Happens in one, depending on the numbers you read, 1 or 2% of the cases that are diagnosed with thyroid cancer every year are anaplastic. Unfortunately, those are a very aggressive subtype of cancer. It's often discovered, even if it appears to be discovered in early stage, there is often undetected spread at the time of diagnosis. So all of those at the time of diagnosis are considered stage four disease or advanced disease, and the 5-year survival rate is only 7%. So thyroid surgery, we've talked about all the lead-in to the surgery, and now we get to talk about the fun part, the surgery. Thyroid surgery is one that's pretty well tolerated by many patients. Many patients who may not be candidates for other surgeries are candidates for thyroid surgery because it doesn't involve a lot of fluid shifts. It doesn't involve a long, prolonged hospital stay. It's a fairly small, limited incision, et cetera, et cetera. It is, however, a surgery that has lots of nuances and will require somebody that actually really knows how to do it. We make an incision. We call it a collar type incision. It extends above the clavicle in a transverse fashion. The patient is positioned in a way that their neck is flexed backward a little bit, so the thyroid gland is brought closer to the surface and more accessible. The incision is made. There are some tissues, some fatty tissues and a thin layer of muscle that are divided. And then below those, there are some muscles that we call the stap muscles, or the sternohyoid and the sternothyroid muscles, which are cross across the plane. You can dissect them away and usually retract them. Rarely you have to divide them in order to obtain access to the thyroid gland, which lies immediately beneath them. You dissect away at the thyroid gland, and then you divide very carefully the vascular attachments of the gland, superior thyroid artery and vein, often a middle thyroid artery and vein, and then the inferior thyroid artery and vein. You remove the gland, and as we talked about, you're either going to be removing a lobe or half of the gland or the entire thyroid. And then you close. You go out the same way you left. You close the muscles. You reapproximate them to cover the trachea, and you close your incision. There are indications for removing half of the gland or one lobe. And you can take that little middle portion here that we call the isthmus, or you can leave it behind depending on where your nodule is located or your personal preference. Some people always take the isthmus, some people never do unless the nodule is close to it. And the indications for doing just removing the one lobe of the gland, or either if you have a nodule that or nodules that are limited to that are only contained in that lobe and you don't know yet what type of tumor it is, or if you know that you have a follicular neoplasm and you don't need to remove the whole gland. The other option is to remove the entire gland, total thyroidectomy. And we talked about, we didn't really talk about this so much, but there are certain cases of hyperthyroidism where the gland is functioning, is over-functioning, but not able to be controlled medically. In that setting, you'd remove the entire gland. A multinodular goiter, again, one that's not amenable to medical management. Papillary cancers will require removal of the entire gland and also of palpable nodes. Medullary cancer will involve removing the entire gland in a neck dissection. Anaplastic cancer, if caught at an early stage, would require removal of the gland. Unfortunately, most of them are caught at the stage where the only surgical treatment options are essentially palliation, whether or not you have a tracheostomy or whatever other way you're trying to control symptoms rather than trying to effect a cure. Completion thyroidectomy is just a word that we use for when we have to go back in at a later date, having removed only half of the gland initially, and remove the remaining thyroid tissue that's present. And the reason to do that is if we had an unclear, or we weren't sure of the diagnosis early on, but when the final pathology comes back as a papillary cancer or a medullary, then we have to go in and remove it. You go through the same incision and remove all of the remaining thyroid tissue. We talked a little bit earlier about the fact that thyroid surgery is a passion, but it's also something that that one has to be very careful about. There are a lot of vital structures that live in the area of the thyroid gland. Some of those are depicted here. There are nervous structures, the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And the superior laryngeal nerve are both nerves that control your voice box. Superior laryngeal nerve is a little less important in that it controls sort of finer functions of your cords and controls pitch. The recurrent laryngeal nerve will control the function of the vocal cords. And if damage on one side can lead to paralysis of one side of the cord, but if you're doing a total thyroidectomy in both, which is very rare, both are subject to being at risk for damage, and that would lead to complete paralysis of the vocal cords and require tracheostomy for the most part. Other important structures or vital structures which live in the area, we talked about the trachea. The esophagus is actually hidden by this picture. It's on the other side. The vagus nerve and the jugular vein are paired structures that lie on either side and are very important. And as we talked about, if there's a collection of blood or hematoma in this area, it can compromise the trachea, would be the first thing it compromises. It can compromise other structures in that area as well. So that's the major reason we watch people overnight after the surgery, is to watch for signs of bleeding so that we can intervene early if necessary. The other structures that are surgically important as we're operating on the thyroid gland are these paired organs called the parathyroid glands. They're small glands that are discrete and separate from the thyroid gland. They can be embedded in it, or they can just be adjacent to it. And there are usually four, although sometimes the anatomy is very variable in this setting, but they're glands that are involved in regulation of calcium metabolism. In the absence of those glands, or the damage to those glands, will lead to a lifelong requirement for calcium supplementation. We're careful to preserve them. If we find that we can't preserve them in place because there is we've had to devitalize them or lose their blood supply in order to remove the thyroid gland, you can reimplant them in a different part of the body, and we do that if they're seen. So there are surgical risks. The risk of the anesthetic is very individual dependent. The risk of blood clot or hematoma in the area is one that we watch for. It's a short-term risk. Wound infections are also a relatively low risk and short-term. Long-term risks, we worry about injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Injury to this one side or one nerve can cause hoarseness or voice loss. And in people that speak for a living, people that are singers, people that are use their voice as part of their function, or in people that don't want to be hoarse, that's something that that is very concerning. It's more likely, damage to that nerve is more likely to occur in patients with large goiters or with cancer, which may be going into the nerve. Hypoparathyroidism can occur particularly with a total thyroidectomy. It's much more rare, of course, when you only remove half the gland, because the other two glands, the other side will also contain parathyroid glands, which can be functional. But the symptoms of hypoparathyroidism, a loss of function of the parathyroid gland, are symptoms of calcium deficiency, muscle cramps, weakness, and twitching. They can be either transient. Sometimes the gland is in place or not damaged, but its blood supply is sort of compromised, and it can regenerate to the point where it's just sort of dinged, so you can you watch it for a while to see if you get return of function, which actually happens fairly frequently. In patients in the short term or in patients in the long term who don't recover function, you may require lifelong calcium supplementation. Hypothyroidism isn't really a surgical risk. It's a potential outcome of surgery, and particularly in surgery, of course, when we remove the entire gland, but even in surgery sometimes where we remove half the gland, that your body with that remaining thyroid tissue may not have adequate supply or adequate production of thyroid hormone. The good news is that thyroid hormone is easily replaceable and easily monitorable. There's a pill that you can take that can replace your thyroid hormone. And there's blood levels of the thyroid stimulating hormone, which we described earlier, that one your physician will monitor to make sure that you're having adequate levels of replacement. The good news about surgery is that we talked about it's an overnight stay in a moderate setting. It's usually very well tolerated by many people, usually a relatively rapid return to usual activities. And this is a post-op where you can see that as we place the scar in skin creases, it's usually a fairly pleasing cosmetic result as well. That's all I have. Thank you very much for your time, and I didn't know if you had any questions. His question was, he has a hyperfunctioning thyroid gland, and I'm assuming they've tried medical management and been unsuccessful. Okay. If successful, a radioactive ablation may work well for you. I think if your physician recommended it, it may be that they think that that's the best option for you. I wouldn't, without knowing the particulars of your situation, I wouldn't say, but it's surgery is something that should be considered in this setting, and can often be beneficial as well, depending on your other risk factors. The question is, how common is this to have thyroid storm after having a radioactive ablation? It is not common, but it is something that we watch for, and it is something that is treatable. That's why they do it in a monitored setting, so that they can give you the treatments immediately. And it's usually a self-limited process. It's usually not. It's usually something that is manageable and managed in the short term. It's not something that's going to be a continuous process that will require involvement. The question asked was whether or not a person who requires surgery or requires radioactive ablation for hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis will feel better after the surgery. And the answer is yes. You should feel much better after the surgery. That sensation that you have as your body is overly revved and overly working to try to respond to the demands of having an abnormal amount of hormone being produced and having all of your on switches on instead of off should make you feel better. Okay, the question was, this gentleman has hyperthyroidism and also is experiencing difficulty or a haziness with vision from one eye. And the question is whether that's related to your thyroid hormone levels or whether related to another process. My suspicion is that it's not related to your hormone levels, because I would expect it to be bilateral in that setting. If you're having a one-sided event, it's usually related to something within that eye. Well, the question asked is a very good one. It's that the person goes to their physician for their annual examination, and there's always noted that they have enlargement or presumably a diffuse enlargement of the gland, and they get some blood work done, and the blood work returns as normal. And the question is, can that still be hiding some abnormality? The short answer to that question is yes. You can have a thyroid goiter that is euthyroid, in other words, it's producing an appropriate level of hormone but is still large. And the way that we manage those, whether surgically or non-surgically, medically or non-medically, depends on your symptoms. If you're having sort of a diffuse, smooth enlargement, but it's not causing any pressure symptoms and it's not very large, then they may choose to just continue to observe you. If, on the other hand, you're having pressure symptoms or other signs that actually it's becoming more of a physical problem, even though you're not having a hormone problem, then the treatment, other treatment options need to be considered. The question is it life-threatening not to treat an over or underactive thyroid? The answer is it depends. It depends on how underactive or how overactive it is. A lot of people have underactive thyroids, and they find that when they go to their physical examination saying, oh, they feel tired, et cetera, et cetera. So you can actually live or function with a hypoactive thyroid. But the question is, to what level does it become hypoactive before it becomes dangerous? And there is a level beyond which your thyroid hormone levels are so low that you are compromising your body and other bodily functions. If the gland is hyperactive, then there's less of a window before you actually notice symptoms and require treatment. And you can be toxic from thyroid hormone levels and be very, very ill. And that's one of the thyroid storm is a sort of a colloquial word for that we use, and that is one of the things that can be very, very life-threatening. Michelle, who's my, the question is whether or not there are natural remedies or natural supplements that you can use to manage thyroid issues. My assistant Michelle is here with me, and she'll laugh because she knows my attitude. And that's basically that there may be benefit, there may not be benefit. There's nothing that's clinically been shown to have benefit. The biggest danger of sort of homeopathic treatments is that if you're using a treatment and using it and ignoring medical advice, then that's potentially dangerous. But there are certain supplements that if you take them in conjunction with medical treatments may or may not be helpful. So essentially, the bottom line is you should speak about it with your medical, with your doctor, with your physician, and get an opinion for your specific case and whatever specific intervention you're choosing to try and supplement to your medical management.
Experience.
The question is that it sounds like a fairly complicated surgery, and do I have experience in doing them? Yes, I have a fair amount of experience in doing them. I trained in Boston, and the general surgeon or the physician that I trained with did hundreds of these a year, and I trained, and I think I got excellent training and used that, and I've done several of them in my practice, many of them in my practice. The bulging in the eye. The question was, if you remember earlier, we showed the picture of the gentleman that had the bulging eyes, the technical term is exophthalmos, and the question was whether or not that's a reversible process, or whether once the thyroid problem is treated, whether that's reversible.